Good morning. Please stand if you're able. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As for me, I shall always have hope. I will praise God more and more, for the Sovereign Lord has been my hope, my rock of refuge to which I can always go. Very warm welcome to St. Paul's this morning. My name is Katie. I am the ministry trainee here, and it's great to be able to be here with you this morning to worship God with you, to share communion, and to hear preach from his word. Pete is going to be continuing to preach in our series, What Made the World Sad, in Genesis 7 and 8. This week, I got to spend some time with some of our youth and lots of others from across London. We went away to Chingford, had lots of fun and very little sleep. And we spent some time reading Proverbs and thinking about that. And I was particularly encouraged by this verse, chapter 1, verse 7. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. We are thinking about how knowing what God wants should be the foundation of all that we do in life, whatever that looks like. Let's pray that we have that fear of the Lord, that wisdom this morning. Father God, thank you for bringing us here this morning. Thank you for your word and the chance we get today to interact with it, to spend time in it, and to build one another up in it. Please would you help us to fear you? Would you teach us this morning? Would we not be foolish, despising wisdom and instruction, but begin to fear you? Amen. Please stay standing, and we are going to sing our first hymn, which speaks of our great, sovereign, sustaining God, sometimes when it like surprises.
Thank you.
your seats. We're going to pray the words of the collect now, which you'll find on your paper sheets. Do you join with me? Lord of heaven and earth, as Jesus taught his disciples to be persistent in prayer, give us patience and courage never to lose hope, but always to bring our prayers before you through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I'm going to hand over to Pete, and we have an interview with a mystery guest.
Good morning, everybody. Nice to see you. My name is Pete. I'm the pastor here, and welcome from me as well. It's lovely to see you here if you're visiting or if you've been away for a little while. We do indeed have a mystery guest, so may I invite Dex Fletcher to come and join me. Welcome, Dex. Now, Dex, just tell us who you are in yourself, your family, and your job, if you would.
Oh, yeah, thanks. My name is Dex Fletcher. As Pete said, I am married to Jules, who's at the back there, and we have three children, Freddie, Phoebe, and Millie. And my job is operations manager here at St. Paul's Haringey.
Right here.
Right
at
here.
Our own church.
In your own church.
Now, for some of you, I can see the lights are going on because you've had emails from Dexter Fletcher over the months.
Quite
he's
a few.
He's been working here. And here he is.
So I'm sorry.
He's the nag.
Yeah.
The one we employed to be the nag. So Dex lives in South London and he can't always be here. He's got a lovely church down there with his family, but today we get to enjoy your fellowship, and you've been kindly working for us as maternity cover, as operations manager.
That's right.
So just, I thought it would be a good opportunity, while we've got Dex here, we could just ask him for an insight on what it's been like working for St. Paul's. You can be honest, I think.
Okay.
and what you've been doing as operations manager, Dex.
Sure. Mostly working for St. Paul's has been a great joy. And that's because I work with a lot of you guys, and I work with Pete, and I work with Katie, and people like that. It's been a great joy to see what God's been doing. And you, I know Pete from quite a while back. We were apprentices together and did some youth work together. And to see what God's been using him for to do here has been hugely encouraging. A small thing to say thank you to most of you. I send a lot of emails, and most of you are so willing to say, yes, I'm so willing to serve. So that's always a great joy for me to get an email back to say, yeah, cool, I'll do that. So thank you. That is God's work in your life, so be encouraged and keep going. Working for these guys is also great. They're great fun. They love the Lord Jesus. They're so passionate about the gospel. And so working for people like that is always a joy. And some of the frustrations, I mean, there's not many. You'll see some of the building work that's been going on around the building. Dealing with contractors, if any of you had building work in your houses or wherever else, you will know contractors are, they test your patience. And so that's been one of the joys and frustrations. Can I ask you here?
Yeah. So as you walked in, you probably noticed it's a bit messy out the front, and Dex is one of the guys who's, you know, typically that would fall on Dex. Could you get rid of all that messy stuff?
And the scaffolding up there that was meant to go on Monday, which...
But you've knocked off some great building work. You've had the front yard repaved, you've helped us finish the backyard, came in while we were doing the toilets.
Well, one of the joys of being here is that Courtney was before me, and she's the real hero here because she basically teed up everything for me, and I just feel like a striker who scored the goal. So she's done all the hard work, and Jesus gets the glory, but somehow I'm here when it's completed. So
Teamwork.
Dex,
we're really grateful to you, and there have been lovely moments that I've been privileged to. In our little office just downstairs, Dex has turned to me from time to time and he said, I've just had the most lovely email from somebody offering to help or responding really warmly, and he said, this is great. I don't know, I haven't met this person face to face yet, but God is clearly doing something in their life. So I'm glad that we can share that with you all. Dex, before we have to leave you, what's the Lord been teaching you lately?
As a dad of three young children, I so want them to be godly and kind and patient and calm with each other, and mostly that's not the case, and I am an impatient guy, so I think the Lord is trying to teach me patience and to rely on him for everything I need. Similarly, like with stuff like building work, I just want to get it done, and often it takes longer than they say it will take, and that's frustrating. And I think through all these things, God has taught me patience to rely on his timing, because his timing is better than mine. And yeah, patience.
Well, he's the right person to go to for
yes.
patience, I find. And finally, Dex, what can we pray for you as you begin to sadly wind up your time with us?
Oh, yeah, thank you. I'm not immediately going back to work after this. Jules, my wife, is a doctor with the NHS, and she's fairly busy. And so for a time, I'm going to be a stay-at-home dad. And that will no doubt test my patience. So you can pray for that, but also just wisdom as we think forward about work and how it might look and various family things. So, yeah.
Okay. Should we pray for Dex now together? Father, we give you thanks for your servant Dex. Thank you also for his family, and we do pray for them with thanksgiving, Father. Thank you for their Dex's ministry amongst us these few months. We're sad it can't be longer. We give you thanks for all that he's achieved and how he's helped us worship the Lord and do things practically, manage our operations here. We pray that you give him such patience. We pray he'd draw on that well of infinite patience in the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, as he does the everyday stuff of being a dad at home and managing his household. And we pray you give him great joy in doing it as you sanctify him day by day. And please provide for him and his family as they go forward. We rejoice, Father, in our fellowship with him this morning and in the church of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Can we give him a round of applause? Let's continue in prayer. Sarah is going to lead us.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we praise you that you are the author of life. You're the God of creation, the one who breathes life into every living being. You ordain all the days of our life before any of them come to be. Your works are wonderful. We know that full well. Father, as we read about the flood over the earth in Genesis this morning, we lift our eyes to you. May we never forget that you are the good, perfect, and holy judge. In 2 Peter, we read that by these waters, the world of that time was deluged and destroyed. By the same word, the present heavens and earth are reserved for fire, being kept for the day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly. So, Lord God, please help us to live holy and godly lives as we look forward to that final day, and please speed its coming. We really need your strength to live blameless lives at home, at work, in public, in private, in our relationships with loved ones and strangers. Please give us more grace than we could imagine to glorify you until that final day. Amen. Father, thank you for sending rain this week on many parts of the UK. Thank you for the nourishment for so many plants, crops, and livestock that have been so heavily affected by the drought this summer. Please keep further drought away, we pray. And we ask for your provision and help for farmers across the country struggling to keep up supplies in these conditions. Please provide for all their needs. And we ask that you would supply the nation's daily bread through these barren days and as the cost of living rises too. Please especially comfort and provide for those who have had homes or businesses damaged by fires or floods recently. May we, your church, be instigators of practical support and compassionate love for all those in need. Amen. Lord, we thank you for our mission partner, Adam Boyce. We praise you for the work that he is able to do with youth and gangs in Haringey, with London City Mission, and for the heart and the skills you've given him to do all you've called him to. Thank you particularly for the link-up camp that 65 young people went on last week. Please cement the Bible teaching they heard in their hearts and minds, we pray. May you keep growing their love for you and keep expanding their understanding and wisdom in Christ. May each of those young people who were there be able to continue meeting with your people throughout the year and be encouraged and encourage others to live wholeheartedly for Jesus. May they shine like stars in this dark universe, we pray, and be salt and light to all those they live amongst. Amen. Finally, Lord God, we pray for those we know in our church family or beyond who are sick in body, mind, or soul. As the Lord Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Please, therefore, comfort our brothers and sisters with hope of a future that is free of death, pain, and sadness. Bless them with faith in you, their glorious Saviour, who has made peace with God possible, and who will one day make all things new. In particular, we pray for Beryl Crawford, Carmel Burrell, Veronica Galloway, Siva Clements, Wilma Best, Olivia Harrison, Suzanne West, Olivia Unwin, and Loretta Medici. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen.
Thanks, Sarah. We're going to have our Bible readings now. Dex and Philip are going to come and read from Genesis 7 and 8, which you can find on page 8 and 9 in your church Bible, and then Pete will come and preach to us. Thanks.
So, first reading, yes, from Genesis chapter 7 on page 8 of your Bibles. Genesis 7. The Lord then said to Noah, "Go into the ark, you and your whole family, because I have found you righteous in this generation. Take with you seven pairs of every kind of clean animal, a male and its mate, and one pair of every kind of unclean animal, a male and its mate, and also seven pairs of every kind of bird, male and female, to keep their various kinds alive throughout the earth. 7 days from now, I will send rain on the earth for 40 days and 40 nights, and I will wipe from the face of the earth every living creature I have made." And Noah did all that the Lord commanded him. Noah was 600 years old when the floodwaters came on the earth. And Noah and his sons and his wife and his sons' wives entered the ark to escape the waters of the flood. Pairs of clean and unclean animals, of birds and of all creatures that move along the ground, male and female, came to Noah and entered the ark as God had commanded Noah. And after 7 days, the floodwaters came on the earth. In the 600th year of Noah's life, on the 17th day of the second month, on that day all the springs of the great deep burst forth, and the floodgates of the heavens were opened, and rain fell on the earth for 40 days and 40 nights. On that very day, Noah and his sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth, together with his wife and the wives of his three sons, entered the ark. And they had with them every wild animal according to its kind, all livestock according to their kinds, every creature that moves along the ground according to its kind, and every bird according to its kind, everything with wings. Pairs of all creatures that have the breath of life in them came to Noah and entered the ark. The animals going in were male and female of every living thing, as God had commanded Noah. Then the Lord shut him in. For 40 days the flood kept coming on the earth. As the waters increased, they lifted the ark high above the earth. The waters rose and increased greatly on the earth, and the ark floated on the surface of the water. They rose greatly on the earth, and all the high mountains under the heavens were covered. The waters rose and covered the mountains to a depth of more than 15 cubits. Every living thing that moved on land
perished. Birds, livestock, wild animals, all the creatures that swarm over the earth, and all mankind. Everything on dry land that had the breath of life in its nostrils died. Every living thing on the face of the earth was wiped out. People and animals and the creatures that move along the ground and the birds were wiped from the earth. Only Noah was left and those with him in the ark. The waters flooded the earth for 150 days. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The second reading is from Genesis chapter 8, verses 1 to 17. But God remembered Noah and all the wild animals and the livestock that were with him in the ark, and he sent a wind over the earth, and the waters receded. Now the springs of the deep and the floodgates of the heavens had been closed, and the rain had stopped falling from the sky. The water receded steadily from the earth. At the end of the 150 days, the water had gone down, and on the 17th day of the 17th month, the ark came to rest on the mountains of Ararat. The waters continued to recede until the 10th month, and on the first day of the 10th month, the tops of the mountains became visible. After 40 days, Noah opened a window he had made in the ark and sent out a raven, and it kept flying back and forth until the water had dried up from the earth. Then he sent out a dove to see if the water had receded from the surface of the ground. But the dove could find nowhere to perch because there was water over all the surface of the earth. So it returned to Noah in the ark. He reached out his hand and took the dove and brought it back to himself in the ark. He waited 7 more days, and again he sent out the dove from the ark. When the dove returned to him in the evening, there in its beak was a freshly plucked olive leaf. Then Noah knew that the water had receded from the earth. He waited 7 more days and sent the dove out again, but this time it did not return to him. By the first day of the first month of Noah's 601st year, the water had dried up from the earth. Noah then removed the covering from the ark and saw that the surface of the ground was dry. By the 27th day of the second month, the earth was completely dry. Then God said to Noah, "Come out of the ark, you and your wife and your sons and their wives. Bring out every kind of living creature that is with you, the birds, the animals, and all the creatures that move along the ground, so that they can multiply on the earth and be fruitful and increase in number on it." This is the word of the Lord. Thank you to God.
Thank you, Philip and Dex. I realise that they're two long readings, aren't they? But I wanted us to try and get this, as much of the sweep of that great story as possible in one go. So that's why. It does feel appropriate to me that in the week that our country finally got some rain, hasn't it been a long drought? And hopefully that's over now and that deluge came this week. So too, it's the same week we get to read this biblical, famous story about the rain coming. So let's put ourselves in God's hands, shall we, as we listen to it. Let's pray. Almighty God, we pray to you and we pray. Many of us will know this story, Father, but we pray you'd speak to us afresh today. Would you show us what this story about Noah and the ark means, we pray. And we ask it in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Well, I feel rather blessed to be amongst you, my friends, because I've had a holiday, and so I'm a bit perky. I feel like I've had a good old sleep and a rest, and I was fortunate to go to France. And I took the ferry with my family, and you know, one of those massive cross-channel ferries. Apparently, it is roughly the same size as Noah's Ark was. And we know that because the measurements are there in chapter 6, so you can check them. And so as I was standing on the deck of my ferry to France, looking out at the massive English Channel, you know, just sea as far as I could see when I was out on the ocean, I thought, oh, so this is roughly what Noah would have seen, just ocean, just rippling water as you stood on deck. And here I've got a Noah's Ark, which you may have played with something similar when you were young. They seem to be pretty ubiquitous, don't they? And I'm going to put these kids at the back so that you can have a little play with it while I talk, if you would like to. When the animals went in, if I leave it here, you can all share it. Someone tell me, when the animals went in, they went in what by what? Two by two, very good. So we're all good, we're on the same page. Enjoy playing with Noah's Ark. But the attentive listener amongst you will have noticed that there's a hard edge to the famous Noah's Ark story. It's not just animals going in two by two. There's also all this hard stuff about God wiping out mankind from the face of the earth and it being a judgment. So what do we do with that? I like to bake bread myself, and there aren't many ingredients in bread. Maybe that's why I like it, because it's kind of simple. You know, flour, water, salt, yeast, a bit of fat, oil or something. You know, five things. That's basically what you need in bread. But I have to pay attention. I was doing this earlier in the week, and I was trying to make some dough. And I've got to pay attention here, because I nearly forgot the yeast. And it's not much good, is it? If you just have a floury, wet lump of something, it needs something to make it rise. And judgment, weird as it may sound, could be like the missing ingredient in Christianity. Sounds strange. If you leave out that key ingredient that God talks about a lot in the Bible, and Noah's Ark is one of those places, then what you find is Christianity doesn't really rise. Maybe I'm stretching the metaphor too much, but it doesn't really work. Where is justice coming from if there is no judgment day? What can the church say to an abuser or a criminal who's escaped the law? What hope have we got of justice without a judgment day? Why did Jesus die on the cross if it wasn't to face the judgment that you and I deserve? So if you leave out that key ingredient in Christianity, then the bread doesn't rise, if you see what I mean. Christianity doesn't hang together. And this is one of those examples I want to say to you. I know this is hard. I know it seems strange, and we'll walk through it, but it has to be there in the recipe. You can't get far in Genesis, and we're doing this series in Genesis 3 to 9 over the summer. We're calling it What Made the World Sad. I mean, we've had, haven't we, if you've been here, we've had Adam and Eve, we've had Cain. Now we're on to his descendants, including Noah. And you get this realization that God is rightly angry at the way humans have trashed his planet. They continually start wars with one another, and they continually ignore him. So we had this summary statement last week in chapter 6, verse 5. If you've got a Bible, you might like to look down if you want to. Chapter 6, verse 5, with Brian preaching. The Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on the earth, and that every inclination of the thoughts of the human heart was only evil all the time. Now, you could snip things like that out of your Bible. You could take a pair of scissors, and every time you get to something you don't like, you could just get rid of it. You just wouldn't have much Bible left. You wouldn't have the story of Noah's Ark. That would disappear from your children's Bible. You wouldn't have the Tower of Babel a few chapters later. You wouldn't have Israel in the desert facing justice. You wouldn't have the Sermon on the Mount. You wouldn't have the death of Jesus, and you wouldn't have the return of Jesus. So there ain't much by the time you've got your scissors and gone to work. So we do need these chapters, and let me try and make it simple. We've got two chapters today, by and large, and so I'm going to try and just show you two things. Firstly, God reigned in judgment, and secondly, God remembered Noah. Okay, God reigned in judgment, God remembered Noah, and then we'll have communion together. Firstly, God reigned in judgment, and I mean that in the sort of, you know, the precipitous way. God reigned, but I know it's, I'm playing with the words, because actually God reigned like a king over that world in chapter 7. Remember that day it rained earlier this week? I wasn't actually in London, I was in somewhere else in the country, but it rained big here, right? I saw some of the photos of Green Lanes, and the first drop of rain. And if you were like me, you thought, oh, this is good. I've never have I wanted it to rain so much as I do right now. And then it rained, and it rained, it rained. Well, imagine that carried on, and it's still raining. Imagine it carried on and on and on. And in chapter 7, verse 11, it says this: in the 600th year of Noah's life, on the 17th day of the second month, on that day all the springs of the great deep burst forth, and the floodgates of the heavens were opened, and rain fell on the earth for 40 days and 40 nights. So, anybody tell me, how long did it rain for? 40, just a bit louder, somebody. 40 days, yes, 40 days. So more than a month of rain. This is where we get that phrase in English, the floodgates were opened. You know, you ever use that phrase? Well, this is, it's right here, rooted in the Bible. And they must have been opened because it rained for a month and a half. People in the Middle East would have been tending their fields, I imagine, trying to make the crops grow or keep the animals fed. And then they felt the first drops of rain. And they thought, great, the crops are going to grow. The animals might be all right. But gradually, I imagine, their joy turned to fear as the rain kept coming and kept coming, and the puddles got bigger and bigger, and soon they're trying to salvage stuff out of their house, right? Because the floodwaters are coming up and it's coming into their house. And perhaps on the third night, let's say, it gets dangerous and people are starting to flee to higher ground. It's still raining. It's still coming. Noah and his family must have had to watch ashen-faced from their boat, which was full of animals, as people died around them in the water and God rained down judgment on them. Why would God do something like that? Well, first of all, just notice with me, it really happened. This isn't some sort of ancient myth that we're to interpret differently. Verse 21, see verse 21? Every living thing that moved on the land perished. Birds, livestock, wild animals, all the creatures that swarm over the earth and all mankind. Everything on dry land that had the breath of life in its nostrils died. Every living thing on the face of the earth was wiped out. People and animals and the creatures that move along the ground and the birds were wiped from the earth. Only Noah was left and those with him in the ark. There's not much in history that shows God's judgment on the world to this extent. It's just vast and appalling, isn't it? I think you're allowed to be appalled and think, what? We're supposed to be shocked, and God took the life of every human being back, just like he had given them the breath of life, so he took it away, except for 8 human beings and 2 of every animal. But, okay, why would God do that? Step with me into the Bible's world. Okay, we live in our own 21st century London world. Step with me into the Bible's world, and we'll try and understand this. When we look at things through God's lenses, we understand that human life is not actually the most precious thing we have. We tend to go around thinking, but this is me, I must protect me at all costs. This is the most precious thing that the world affords. But the Bible has a different view, and it says, faithfulness to God is the most precious thing in the world. How do I know that? Well, Jesus comes along as the perfect human, the Son of God, and he actually is okay with his life being snuffed out if he could be faithful to God. So he has this attitude, if I could just live for my Father, then you can take my life away, painful as it may be. So we see here with God's lenses on, actually, faithfulness to God is what matters even more than protecting my own life. Some people find it really hard to believe that water could cover the whole entire earth to a depth of 6 meters, as it says in verse 20. That is a lot of water, isn't it? I can't imagine it, but it's a lot of cubic meters of water on top of the earth's crust. Let's talk about that for a moment. What do you do with improbable statements like that in the Bible? Well, I just want to encourage you. A Christian's basic attitude is, I trust God. Okay? So just start out real basics. God is good. He wouldn't have sent Jesus Christ if he wasn't good and he didn't love me. So I trust him. And there are some unreliable people in the world, but my God isn't one of them, so I trust him. That's the just stake in the ground. Then I go on from there and I think, well, my experience of the world does tell me that natural disasters happen. You know, floods do happen, volcanoes erupt and earthquakes happen, tsunamis occur, and that's sad. Indeed, I know that there are 2 other famous accounts of the ancient world. They're in the British Museum, so we can read them, and they both talk about a great flood. So it just seemed possible to me that there was indeed a great flood from history alone. And I go on from there to try and work out, well, what happened in this case? And in this case, personally, I think it's possible that there was a great flood that covered the entire known world. You with me on that? So I think it's possible that because mankind hadn't spread around the entire planet yet, when it says the whole world was covered and every man and woman perished, I think it's possible that indeed that means the whole of humanity was wiped out and the flood covered the known Middle East. I wouldn't go to the stake over it, but I know from Genesis chapter 10, a few chapters later, that mankind hadn't spread much beyond the Mediterranean by this point. So we can tell that from the records. Later in Genesis, it says, the whole world came to Joseph to buy grain. And I don't think we're to understand every single human being came to Joseph to buy grain. I think that's a phrase that means lots of people were coming, the whole known world. So too here, I think it could mean that everyone in the known world, the Middle Eastern area, perished under this great flood which covered that whole region. That's devastating enough, isn't it? That's awful, tragic, seismic. It makes the same point that God was raining judgment on the world. Chapter 7 is this deterioration. If you read it, the waters, they just keep rising. Chapter 7, glug. Chapter 7, more water. Chapter 7, still more water. There's terror rising with the water. And then you get to the end of the chapter and it stops. And somebody just tell me, I need a bit more help here. Chapter 8, verse 1, Genesis chapter 8, verse 1, it says, but God, what? Thank you. Remembered Noah. Do you see that? That is the turning point. It's the hinge. It's where the waters have stopped rising. And that happens. God remembered Noah. And from that time onwards, in chapter 8, the waters start going down. So I want you to take that. If you remember four words from this morning, why not take that? But God remembered Noah. Made all the difference in the story, and it'll make all the difference in our life too. But God remembered Noah. That's our second point. And all the wild animals and the livestock that were with him in the ark, and he sent a wind over the earth and the waters receded. Not like a human being remembers, you know, oh, I left something in the oven. Oh my goodness, I remembered. Not like that, you know, this is God with perfect knowledge. This is a sort of covenant remembering. I remember you. A bit like a spouse, you know, they may find that they're distracted by another attractive person, but then they say, but I remember, I'm married, and I return in my heart and my mind and my body to my spouse. You know, that's a sort of covenant remembering. I remember you. So God remembered Noah. And just as we saw in chapter 7 that the situation got worse and worse, so in chapter 8, the situation gets better and better and better. And we'll finish off the story next week with our all-age service. The waters recede, the land appears, eventually the door of the ark is opened and Noah and his family come blinking into the sunlight. Oh, we're back. And I think this will be my last interactive question for you. What did Noah have to do in the meantime while he waited? Chapter 8, verse 10. Noah. A bit louder, somebody. Waited. Noah waited. You see that, chapter 8, verse 10? He waited. And what a lot of waiting there must have been to do. He waited in his weird boat. You know, it's such an odd boat if you try and draw a picture of it. I don't think there are any windows. You know, it's got decks and decks for the animals, and it's got this big roof on top. And he waited in his dark little big boat with his little band of fellow believers, waited for the sunshine, waited for the salvation and the land that God had promised. And it must have been really stinky. all those animals, it just must have ponged. But he waited. It must have seemed pretty unlikely, first of all, that God would send the flood, and then that he would send the dry land. But he did. It's a bit like being a Christian, isn't it, in some ways? Seems pretty weird. You know, I come to this giant building every week, and I spend time with a relatively small number of other believers, and I wait. I wait and wait for the salvation that God's promised. Seems to take a long time. Sometimes I feel foolish or weak. But what else am I going to do? I mean, God has spoken, says it's coming. I trust him, and I wait. In all of chapters 7 and 8, Noah waits. Do you know how long? 370 days. if you put all the timings together, it seems like he waited 370 days, which is just more than a year, isn't it? So my goodness, that's a long time to wait in a boat, on a smelly ship. It's not a situation that anyone would choose. I got that ferry to France and it took 8 hours. My goodness, 8 hours can seem like a long time. When would I get to my holiday? But at least you know you're going on holiday. Noah, he had no rudder, he had no motor on his boat, he had no sail. It's just a floating lifeboat to stay on the water. And he waited and he waited and he waited. But given the choice between that and drowning in God's righteous anger, I know what he would have chosen. He would have chosen to wait. I'd rather have the lifeboat, thanks, than gasping and floundering and drowning. Now, you may not think the Christian life is attractive, my friend. You may look at the Christians going to their church and you think, that looks boring, or you know, why do they do that? And it just seems not the life I would choose. Yes, but if you have all the ingredients of Christianity, including the judgment, then you know which one to choose. I would rather be with Christ, safe with him. Let me try and illustrate as we begin to wrap all this together. I read recently about Tilly Smith. Now, Tilly was a 10-year-old girl, and she was on holiday with her family in 2004 in Thailand on Boxing Day when that great tidal wave struck. She was walking with her family about 8, 9 o'clock one morning along the beach, and she saw the sea was sort of fizzing and the tide had weirdly just gone out all of a sudden. And Tilly, who's 10 years old, remembered a geography video that she'd been shown just recently by her teacher. And she remembered the word that he'd taught them, tsunami. And apparently not many other people knew about tsunamis at that stage, but Tilly, the penny dropped in her mind and she started shouting to her family, tsunami, it's a tsunami, I've learned about this. And her parents didn't believe her at first. They said, no, we're just out for a walk on holiday, just quiet down. She said, no, Mum and Dad, it's a tsunami. She started shouting to the other people on the beach, it's a tsunami, everybody, you have to get away. People didn't want to believe her. But she happened to find a Japanese security guard who knew about tsunamis from Japan, and he helped her get people off the beach. Tilly's mum was one of the last people to reach safety. She was one of the most skeptical. No, darling. No, don't be silly. Just let us enjoy our holiday. But eventually, even she too saw the signs and she came running for safety. Everybody on the beach was saved. Absolutely everybody, including Tilly's whole family. My friends, it may not seem attractive to be the one saying, there's a judgment coming, there's a judgment coming. But if it's true, it's true. Would you turn with me to Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7, if you have a Bible. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7. It's on page 1209, near the back of your Bibles. Hebrews chapter 11, page 1209. Noah is mentioned 5 times in the New Testament, 2 of them by Jesus. And this is one of those 5 times. You see, Hebrews 11, verse 7, page 1209. It says, by faith Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear built an ark to save his family. By faith he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness that is in keeping with faith. See what it's saying? Noah had this holy fear. So he warned people and he saved his family. Now, I don't know about you. I don't often feel like I've got the faith of Noah. I am such a strong Christian. You could write about me in your Bible. You know, put me in Hebrews chapter 11 because I am awesome. I'd never feel like that. I feel I have a weak faith. I'm just trying to obey God. Sometimes it's enough just to want to pray. But I do identify with Noah's family. And here it talks about, doesn't it? Noah, in holy fear, built an ark to save his family. So we're not told what the names of the women were in the story. I wish we were. I wish I knew the name of Noah's wife, Noah's daughters-in-law. But I feel a bit like them, you know. What were they feeling? What did they say to Noah? No, come on, Noah, don't be silly. Stop building that ark. Oh, really, Noah, is it really going to rain that much? Come on. Oh, Noah, is it really going to recede and we're going to see dry land again? What happened around the dinner table? But they stuck with him. And the great news is, just like they tagged along with Noah and they went into the ark and were saved, we can tag along with Jesus and we can go into his tomb with him, as it were, and be saved. See, Jesus Christ is the better Noah. He had to come and preach judgment, unpopular things, and he had to be wrapped up in darkness and gloom, and then he had to die and wait for the light of day. And then on Easter Sunday, Jesus walked out of the tomb, blinking onto dry land, bringing his family of believers with him. So can I encourage you, tag along with Jesus. Just be like Noah's family. You know, you don't have to be the strong one, that's Jesus. But you can tag along with him, with his holy fear. If Christianity seems too overwhelming to you because, I don't know, the Bible is too big and confusing, church is too complicated, the language is too unfamiliar, then just do what Noah's family did. Just tag along with Jesus. Follow him and he'll keep you safe. Maybe you're skeptical about Christianity, including the judgment bits. Maybe it seems too far-fetched, perhaps too old-fashioned, perhaps too off-putting in this day and age. Well, do what Noah's family did, but do it with Jesus. Tag along with Jesus, because he seems really sure about Judgment Day. He's got this solid, unshakable faith. Maybe it's time for you to refresh your memory about what Jesus actually said. Have you read the Gospels recently? If you read Matthew's Gospel or Luke's Gospel, you realize Jesus talks about Noah and a whole bunch of other stuff besides. You could read that before the sun sets tonight. And finally, if you're a Christian already, right, which many of you are, maybe you feel like, okay, I'm in the ark, I'm in the boat, I'm just tired, just weary, just been doing this for a while now. Well, look, we don't know what went on behind the scenes with Noah and his family. We don't know what they said to him. Oh, Noah, we're so tired. When will this be over? Can we please see the dry land like you promised? It must have felt like a long time to wait, but you're in the right place. You stick with Jesus. Don't be tempted to go away from him. Maybe you could renew your commitment to him today, you know. Tell him, Jesus, I'll wait with you for as long as it takes. Let's pray together. Just take a moment in quiet, and if the Lord has laid something on your heart today, then just speak to him silently about that now. Let's pray together. By faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear, built an ark to save his family. Our Lord God, we see in Noah that this great picture of our Lord Jesus, who in holy fear built an ark to save his family, his church. And we love you, Jesus. We praise you. We tremble in fear of judgment to come, but we rejoice in the safety that you offer us. And we pray, Lord, you would help us, we pray, as we struggle, as we believe, as we stick with Christ. We pray you give us all faith for the journey ahead as we wait and we wait and we wait and we long for that dry land of the new creation. I pray in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Please would you stand if you're able to, and we'll sing Rock of Ages, Cleft for Me.
Father God, we praise you so much that you remembered Noah, that you bring judgment, but you provide mercy and grace. Thank you for how we see that in the flood, in Noah, in the ark. And thank you even more for how we see that in Jesus. Please, will we be people who tag along with him? Would we be people who know that we cannot save ourselves, that only you can clean us? And would we be found in him today and always? Amen. Brothers and sisters, we're going to declare our faith in the words of the Apostle Creed with Christians across the world and down the centuries. If you are someone who is tagging along with Jesus, these are your words. This is our story. So you'll find the words on your paper sheet. Please join with me if you. I believe in God, the Father, the Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He is seated in heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of the saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
Also with you.
Let's offer one another a sign of peace. As we stay standing, you'll need a laminated card that says the Lord's Supper. The Lord's Supper is given that all who participate may remember Christ's death on the cross once for all to pay for sins, and his glorious resurrection to reign at God's right hand as Lord and Judge. It is given that we who are in need of God's sustenance and fatherly care might feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. It is given as a memorial by Jesus himself and practiced by his apostles and earliest followers. And pray together. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all people, we acknowledge and lament our many sins and the wickedness we have committed time after time by thought, word, and deed against your divine majesty. We have provoked your righteous anger and your indignation against us. We earnestly repent and are deeply sorry for these our wrongdoings. The memory of them weighs us down. The burden of them is too great for us to bear. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that from this time forward we may always serve and please you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please take your seats. And would you hear and take to heart these words our Savior Christ says to all who truly turn to him? Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Hear what St. Paul says. This saying is true and worthy of full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Hear what St. John says. If anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in your tender mercy gave your only Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made thereby his one oblation of himself once offered a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, he instituted and in his holy gospel commanded us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until he comes again. Hear us, merciful Father, we humbly pray, and grant that we, receiving these gifts of your creation, this bread and this wine, according to your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers in his most blessed body and blood. Who, in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread, gave you thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Amen. Could I have my helpers, Katie and Terry? This is the Christian family meal. So if you're one tagging along with Jesus, trusting him in repentance and faith, then you're welcome at his table, even if you don't normally come to this church. If you're not yet a Christian, then we say it's better just to stay in your seat before you make this tangible declaration of faith. And there's a prayer for reflection in the grey box that you might like to pray to God. Kids, you're welcome to come forward, and I'd love to pray for you when you do. Draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Amen.
if you pick up your laminated sheets, we're going to say the prayer after communion together. It's the one in bold on the back. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son, brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. May we who share in Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We who the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so that we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. It's now time for some church family news. You should have an insert that looks a little bit like this, which has everything that you need to know on it. Just going to draw your attention to three things. First of all, on Wednesday, we have our prayer meeting, our church prayer meeting. It's going to be next door at Pete's house from 8 till 9. It's one of our most important meetings during the week, and it's a really wonderful time to come together and lift up our church, our community, and our world to prayer in God. Do come along. If you don't like praying out loud, that's okay. We would love to see you there and be encouraged by you and encourage you as we pray together. Number two, it is your last chance to order one of the fun St. Paul Haringey t-shirts. Maybe you feel like now you've met Dex, you can finally send him an email. Today's your chance. It's your last chance. Please, would you send him an email if you'd like a t-shirt with your name and your size by tonight? The t-shirts are a really fun, exciting chance to wear them. Maybe if you're doing the park run or some gardening or serving in some way at church. By tonight, please email Dex. And finally, you should have a little flyer that looks something like this in your service sheet as well. It's for the Haringey Village Fete, which is one of my favourite dates in our calendar. It's great fun. We have a bouncy castle, an ice cream van, and lots of stalls and food. And it's a really wonderful chance to get to know our community better, to welcome them into the church building. It's really exciting. I'm really excited about it. But we do need some help. If you are available to set up on the Friday, or help man the bouncy castle, or stand on a stool, or to clear down, even if you're just available for an hour on that Saturday, we would absolutely love your help. Please would you talk to Marvlin, he's at the back there, or drop her an email. We really need your help, so please let us know if you're able to do that. Thank you. We're going to sing once more together and point each other towards our true heavenly home. Let's stand and sing, "There is a hope that burns within my heart." Father God, would you help us in the waiting? Would you help us in the times that seem stormy? Would we rely on you? Would we tag along with Jesus in his death and resurrection, knowing where our future home is, knowing that this is not the end of our story, it is simply the beginning. Please would we give us patience to wait like Noah in the storm, in the drying up of the land. Would we wait? Would we encourage one another to do so? Would we point each other to Jesus and to our heavenly home each day this week? Amen. It's nearly the end of our time together. It's been a joy to worship with you this morning, to look at God's word. Do stick around afterwards, chat to someone, particularly if you're new, say hello. We'd love to get to know you better. As we close, hear these words of blessing. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us always. Amen. Go in the peace of Christ. Thanks be to God.